In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Welcome to our service for this, the second Sunday of Easter. And so we continue really to reflect on the Easter stories, the stories of God's new life breaking in to our world. And as we do that, we just pause for a moment's quiet and we pray that God's new life will break into our lives. Even when we fail God, even when there are times when we let God down and let ourselves down. So we come before God to seek healing and forgiveness. Let us acknowledge our problems and doubts, the pains we have suffered and the hurts we've inflicted. Risen Lord, for our difficulties and denials, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy. Risen Lord, for our careless thoughts and careless words, Christ have mercy, Christ have mercy. Risen Lord, for our hasty assumptions and hasty actions, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to listen to Keith as he reads to us our reading for today.
Hear the Gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ according to John. It was evening on the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails of his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name.
One of the things we found quite a challenge, in an interesting good way, at church in recent years, has been having someone in our congregation who's blind. it challenges lots of your ways of doing things. You think, that doesn't work for Dovrig. And there are many things that we have to just kind of analyze and think, how do we make that work? And it's true with many disabilities, of course, that you have to adapt things. And when you know somebody who has a particular disability, you're able to think about how to do things in a different way that suits them as well. John Hull was a Christian theologian who became blind in his 40s, and he wrote very powerfully. There's a lovely film about his life, actually, that's well worth watching. But John kind of investigated the scriptures from the viewpoint of somebody who's blind. And he found that John's gospel in particular is quite challenging because there's a lot of negative imagery about blindness. A lot of people being healed from blindness, but also a lot of criticism of people being blind in the sense of not understanding things, not seeing things from God's point of view. But it's quite hard to hear this when you yourself are blind. And actually, today's reading is one of the only places in John's Gospel where we have a positive image of blindness, in a sense. Because in today's reading, Jesus says, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." And he's addressing this in the context of Thomas has missed out on meeting with the risen Christ the week before. Thomas suffering from FOMO, fear of missing out. His friends have all recounted their tale of meeting with Jesus. If it was the Instagram generation, they'd have all been sharing their photos, and he'd have been looking at the photos, feeling that he was missing out. There are no photos, of course. It's not the Instagram generation, but I think Thomas definitely had a sense that he had missed out. And it's not surprising that he then is a little bit cynical. He wants evidence. He wants to believe, but he wants evidence. So Jesus stands before him and offers him the opportunity to put his fingers in the wounds and so on, to be very tangible, to be very hands-on. But actually, Thomas doesn't need that. He's confronted with the risen Christ and he believes. But Jesus goes on to say these words, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." And I guess that's us, because we cannot go back. We cannot go and stand there with the risen Christ. We cannot go back to the tomb and be there on Easter day and see what happens. And if we did, I don't know. I don't know what we'd see. I don't know. What we have is the story. And the story tells us that Jesus rose from the dead. And the evidence of the disciples have changed lives is that Jesus rose from the dead. But it's a big story. It's a big story that goes back to the foundation of the world, of the universe, that God created the universe and loved all things and wants to be united with all things, but wants that to be a relationship of a kind of a grown-up relationship, a relationship of choice. And God longs for us to be reunited with God. God longs for things to come together. And we cannot see necessarily with our eyes. We cannot feel with our hands. We don't have that choice to kind of grasp hold of God. Interestingly, Thomas has the offer of touching Jesus. In the garden, Mary is told not to touch Jesus, perhaps because she wants to hold on to him, to not let him go. And we cannot grab hold of God. But what we can do is come to believe that God is with us and alongside us and will bring all things to unity and peace. Amen. So we're going to turn to prayer for a moment. Let us pray. We pray for our world with all its hurts. We pray for God's new life to break into our world, to bring healing and transformation and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for all those who are ill and all those who are struggling, that they would know the help and support of others and of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And a prayer for today. Risen Christ, whose absence leaves us paralyzed, but whose presence is overwhelming, breathe on us with your abundant life, that where we cannot see, we may have courage to believe, that we may be raised with you. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so thank you for joining us today. It's lovely to have you with us. And do join in with other things that we've got going on. Come down to church and meet us there if you're able to. Do join in with the online content as well. And today we're going to finish with another Easter hymn. David Hillary is going to sing for us The Lord of the Dance. I danced in the morning when the world was begun. And we'll have some images of the life of the church as the background for this. Some images I've used on the front cover of our annual report, which is available, and ask me for a copy if you would like one, or find it. We'll probably have it on the website and things. So a prayer of blessing to finish. God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give you joy and peace in your faith, and the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he. I dance for the scribe and the Pharisee. they would not dance and they wouldn't follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came with me and the dance went on. Dance then whenever you bring me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be. On the Sabbath, and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me on high and left me there on a cross to die. Dance then wherever you may be. I am a lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone, but I am a dance and I still go on. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all. They cut me down and I leapt up high. I am the life that'll never, never die. I'll live in you if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I lead you all wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance, said he.